welcome to the Santa Ponce Community Church. It is a great privilege to be able to be in your space, whether it's your house, whether you are in the garden, whether you're out somewhere walking around. It's wonderful to be able to spend time together in this way and to be able to get into the Word of God. I'm very excited today. We're going to be beginning the book of Revelation. You know, there's been a lot of talk at the in recent times about end times and things, you know, different views, different things, different perspectives on the whole thing. And I'm hoping that as we go into the book, that we will be able to see some, get some clarity on what the Bible does say, what the Bible could say, and what the Bible does not say. And so anyway, excited. We're going to do a small intro this morning. And we, our prayer is that we will be, like the very book says, that we will be blessed as we read the book of Revelation together. Let's worship the Lord.
You never change, you never fail, oh God.
So let's jump right into the book of Revelation. Whenever we study any book of the Bible, we must ask ourselves, who wrote it? Who was it written to? Why was it written? What is the theology? What is the thing about God that we learn through that book? And here we find ourselves with a book. He says, I, John. And John, no doubt, is the disciple whom Jesus loved that the gospel talks about. And no doubt it is the disciple whom Jesus, when he asked Jesus, where are you staying? Jesus replied to him, come and you will see. What an amazing thing, how Jesus always does exceedingly and abundantly beyond all we can think or ask. You see, John, no doubt, his expectation was that he would see where Jesus was staying on earth. But when Jesus said, come and you will see, he was going to show him where he was staying. He was going to show him how he was going to deal with man, the cleansing of the lepers, the blind seeing, the walking on the water, the feeding of the 5,000. You see, John saw exceedingly and abundantly beyond all he could think or ask. He just wanted to know where he was staying, but Jesus fulfills much more than that. Then he saw, no doubt, I mean, we know that he was at the cross, and he saw Jesus at the cross and saw a terrible death. But then he saw an incredible, a marvelous, a wonderful resurrection. And he was able to touch and handle and even eat breakfast with Jesus after he had died and rose again. After these encounters with Jesus on and off for those 40 days, then as they were waiting in Jerusalem, he got to see or experience just the conversions of thousands of people as the Holy Spirit was given to the church, as or birthed the church. And we see that John got to see the gospel going out throughout the world. But here we find ourselves that even what we would have thought was exceedingly and abundantly beyond all we can think or ask, one of the things that John keeps saying in this book is, and I saw. In chapter 1, verses 12 and 17, if you look at these verses, look at verse 12, it says, then I turned to see a voice that spoke to me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. In chapter 4, verse 4, it says, around the throne, 24 elders. And on the throne, I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white robes. In 5, 1 and 2, and I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside and on the back, sealed with seven seals. In verse 2, then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to take the scroll and to loosen its seals? Chapter 6, verse 1 and verse 9, it says, now I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, come and see. Verse 9 says, when he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. 7, 1 and 2, after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, then that the wind should not blow on the earth, on the sea, or on any tree. Then I saw another angel descending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And on, I mean, it's just, all you have to do is look for the word saw. And even to the point where I'm just going to skip towards the end, it says, chapter 21, verse 1 and 2, it says, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. And then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. What an amazing experience John had. What an amazing question he gave. What a simple question he gave Jesus. Where are you staying? And what an amazing plan Jesus had for his life, that he should say, come and you will see. And the very distinctive of John's life became, and I saw, and I saw, and I saw. Never be afraid to know Jesus, to follow Jesus. He has the best intentions. He is the most majestic. He will overwhelm our hearts. He like in Solomon and in 1 Kings chapter 10, it's just so amazing to me when the Queen of Sheba came to see the King Solomon. It says in 1 Kings chapter 10, now when the Queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to test him with many hard questions. She came to Jerusalem with a very great retinue, with camels that bore spices, very much gold and precious stones. And when she came to Solomon, she spoke with him about all that was in her heart. So Solomon answered her all her questions. There was nothing so difficult for the king that he could not explain it to her. And when the Queen of Sheba had seen all the wisdom of Solomon, the house that he had built, the food on his table, the seating of his servants, the service of his waiters and their apparel, his cupbearers and his entryway by which he went up to the house of the Lord, there was no more spirit left in her. Then she said to the king, it was a true report which I heard in my own land about your words and your wisdom. However, I did not believe the words until I came and saw with my own eyes. And indeed, the half was not told me. Your wisdom and prosperity exceed the fame which I heard. Happy are your men, and happy are these your servants who stand continually before you and hear your wisdom. And you see, the Queen of Sheba traveled so far. And when she saw King Solomon, and she saw his wisdom, she saw the temple, and when she saw his servants and the meals, there was no more heart left in her. And here in the book of Revelation, it says that John fell down as dead as he saw not only the incarnate Son of God, not only the resurrected Son of God, but the very exalted and glorified Son of God. And you know, there is never enough of Jesus. There will always be more to discover. There will always be more to know. There will always be more surprises. When Jesus says, come and you will see, he does exceedingly and abundantly beyond what we can think or even ask. What a tragedy when we become bored, or when we sort of come across Christians who seem bored with Christianity, who seem bored with Jesus. To me, it just doesn't compute. There's always more. And if you do not know the Lord today, I want to encourage you, not in a physical location, but in a very spiritual step. He says to you, come and you will see. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He wants to manifest himself to you. And what you could do is just say, Lord, I just want to know you. And I would ask, go ahead, read the book of Revelation. You will see. You will see how it moves you to the core. But John not only had this amazing invitation and this amazing experience in his life, but he had, by this time, he was a transformed man. He was on the island of Patmos. He was there because of his faith. He was persecuted, and they put him in exile very much like in the movie The Conte of Monte Cristo, where he was just exiled in this prison island all by himself. And it is there that God spoke. But by this time, I want us to realize this. He was not the man who had met Jesus. You know, sometimes we think just because we've met Jesus that we've sort of arrived. Oh man, not only do we see wonderful things in following Jesus, but we also see wonderful things happening in us. You see, John was known as one of the sons of thunder, a bad temper. He's the one that said to Jesus, "Should we call fire from heaven and just consume these Samaritans? These people that are a different race, a different nationality, a different color, just different than we are. Should we just annihilate them because they don't respect you?" And he had that fire in him of wrath. And Jesus rebuked them and says, "You don't know what spirit you're of." And he melted them. He completely changed his nature to the point where he, after saying, "Should we consume them?" In writing 1 John, he says, "Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called the children of God." 1 John 3:14, "We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren." And John had gone from being a feisty, fiery, sort of bullying kind of a person. He went to being this apostle of love. And you know, love is not something that we feel. When we say we love somebody, it is not seen by the emotion that we feel for somebody. It is seen by the very actions that we take towards somebody. Remember, it was Jesus that was betrayed by a kiss. It was a great demonstration of love, but it was a great betrayal. The Bible says that each man proclaims his own love, and we all feel like Julio Iglesias in some ways. We all feel like we're just these great lovers. But the Bible says every man proclaims his own world, his own love, but a faithful man who can find. There's a big difference into feeling loving and being faithful. And here, the man has been transformed. Not only does he have a good disposition, a different disposition, but he's been changed. He's a balanced man. Love, not sentimentalism. Judgment, not discontrolled anger. Wrath, with soberness. And Revelation is a book of thunder, but with tenderness. And it is interesting that it would be John, the son of thunder, that actually God chose to write this book. It is a book of great hope. It is a book of great comfort. It is a book of justice finally being done. So many times we look, we watch the news, or we think of all the things that are going on, and we just cry out, "Lord, how long must I see evil and you do not hear?" Like we've been studying in the book of Habakkuk. How long? And the book of Revelation is that book that shows us, you know what? That God is patient. God is kind. God is merciful. And not wanting any man to be lost. But God is also just, and he is holy, and he's angry with the injustices that are going on in the earth. And he will one day judge the world in righteousness through the very person of Jesus Christ. It is a book of wrath being poured out on the ungodly. It is very joyful and yet at the same time, very sad. And there are certain, or before we move to that, we need to realize, you know, I know there's an element of fear in our hearts when we think of wrath and we think of judgment. But think about our world. I mean, we have courts. We have prisons to deal with wrongdoing. And we have no problem with those, especially when it is us that has been wronged. And I believe, with all my heart, I mean, I think it's just common sense that the reason we have these courts of justice, as imperfect as they might be, the reason we have these prisons, as imperfect as they might be, the reason we love our children, as imperfect as we might love, the reason we have mercy, as imperfect as we might have mercy, as the reason we are righteous, as imperfect as we demonstrate righteousness, it is because we are created in the image of God. So it should not be strange to us if one day God, not imperfectly, but perfectly, deals with the evil and the wrongdoing that is going on in the world. It should bring great comfort to us, particularly when we've suffered wrong. And it should be great comfort, bring great comfort to us, particularly when we've hid ourselves in Christ and we've received the forgiveness that we didn't deserve, the blessings that we didn't deserve. It should be a great comfort that in spite of us, we have a hope of a new heaven and a new earth. Oh, what a great, great hope Jesus has provided for us. And there are peculiar features of the book. It is the only book in the Bible that contains a special blessing or a promise to those who read it. So there you go. You want to be blessed? Read the book of Revelation. Just grab it. You could probably do it in a couple hours. Just read from beginning to end. Revelation 1:3 says, "Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near." So, to read it. You'll be blessed by reading it. You'll be blessed by hearing it. Whether it's teachings, whether it's just like in our times today, hearing somebody else read it, or whether it is having an MP3 Bible where we just have it read to us. Not in a mystical way, but the truth in it bring a blessing to our life. But notice that it's not just reading and hearing. And this goes for all the Word of God. The whole Word of God has been given to bless us. But we cannot be hearers of the words only, but doers. What's the point of being in a fire or in a boat sinking or in a perilous situation or in a very blessed situation where someone said to us, "Hey, go to the bank. There's €1 million there waiting for you." If we listen, if we enjoy it, if we have it read to us, but we actually never take action to do it, to go to the bank, to get out of the house, to get off the boat. What's the point? But there's also a curse in this book. There's also a curse to those who tamper with it. Now, this is something that to me is crazy, because when it comes to the book of Revelation, it's amazing how many opinions people have. And I'm going to do my best to really stick to what we do know, and we're able to be realistic what we don't know and what views we might not hold, but there's truth in it. But here in Revelation 22, verse 18 and 19, it says, "For I testify to everyone who hears the words of this prophecy of this book, if anyone adds to these things, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of the book of the prophecy, God shall take away his part from the book of life, from the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. And it is only normal. It is only normal that if you were to write a contract with somebody else, and then you found a court found that you had tampered with it and you added or taken away for your benefit or for other people, that you would be in a lot of trouble. Maybe if you were an heir and you came across the document that showed you your inheritance and you sort of added a couple houses there and took them away from somebody else, there's no doubt that you would be in trouble. How much more with the very word of God, as he tells us how things are going to pan out, if we just treat it lightly, just play around with it. Listen, we don't go to the Bible to bring our meaning into the Bible. We go into the Bible to grab out the meaning from the author. And it is a very serious thing. I don't understand. When talking to people, sometimes you just have this sense that it's like, oh, I like this part, and I don't like that part, and I would like to change that part, and I wish it was, you know, and all these things. Or these things really are the words of Jesus, but those things are not really from God. You know, it says in Isaiah that he will look upon him who trembles at his word. And there is a sense that we should realize that he who made everything is the one that wrote this book. The whole 66 books of the Bible, and in particular today, the book of Revelation, show we are not to tamper with it. We are to read it. We are to receive it. We are to yield to it. But there's a couple of the features about the book that I think they're quite interesting. Number one, the number 7 keeps coming up, and I'm not going to get into. In general, normally the book of 7 has always been a book of completion. You know, on the 7th day, God rested from all his works, and here in the book of Revelation, you have 7 candlesticks in Revelation 1, 12 and 20. You have 7 churches in 1, 4. You have 7 seals and 7 trumpets in chapters 4 through 11. You have 7 thunders in chapter 10, verse 3. You have 7 bowls in 15, 16, and 17, 1. And, you know, it's a sense of completion in everything that God does. In everything that God is doing in this book, there's going to be a sense of completeness. The words "no more" come up, funny enough, 7 times I've got here. No more sea in 21:1. No more death, 21:4. No more sorrow, 21:4. No more crying, 21:4. No more pain, 21:4. No more curse, 22:3. And no more night, 22:5. And one of my favorite things in the book of Revelation is to compare the book of Revelation with the book of Genesis. In the book of Genesis, we have the beginning of mankind. We have the beginning of the earth. God created the heavens and the earth. He created every creature. And then he creates men and makes them, puts them in charge of the creation. And then everything goes wrong. And in Genesis, death comes into the world. And we have the history of redemption into the book of Revelation. And in Revelation, there's no more death. In Genesis, sin enters into the world. In Revelation, there is no more sin. At the end, obviously. In Genesis, it tells of Satan triumphing over man. In Revelation, it talks of Satan being overthrown. In Genesis, there's a curse put upon the earth. In Revelation, there is no more curse. In Genesis, man is excluded from the tree of life. In Revelation, there is the admission to the tree of life in chapter 2, verses in chapter 22, verse 2. And you see this wonderful progress of redemption from the day the man messed up everything to the very preparation of the coming of the Messiah, to the very redemption as he ascends into heaven. And yet he said he would build his church, and we deal with this church age where the Holy Spirit is, and like it says in Revelation, the Spirit and the church, they say come, and the Holy Spirit and the church, they're bringing the love of God to people. Salvation is coming, history is unfolding, but then you see the very end of the redemption of man and the very end of the judgment of sin, Satan, and those that choose that side of evil. What a wonderful thing. You know, there are some people that like to read books, and they read, obviously many people like to read books, but they like to read books in a particular way. They like to read the last page first, which is a bit weird sometimes. But they like to read the last page first, and then they begin to read, and they kind of know where it's going. And it's such a wonderful thing that in our lives, we are able to see that the end from the beginning. We're able to see that life is more than just about us, our particular lives. That there's history, that it is His story, and that we get to be a part of it. What a wonderful privilege. And I want to just very briefly tackle four methods of interpretation that are used in reading and in studying the book of Revelation. I can kind of identify and sympathize with three of them. One I have a hard time with, but three of them I think that there's truth to them. And we'll see. We'll go into it. But four methods of interpretation as we tackle this book. One is the allegorical, non-literal approach. This comes from the Alexandrian School of Theology, and it regards the entire Bible as an extensive allegory to be interpreted in a non-literal sense. This was done by people like Origen and later by Augustine. And they interpret the book of Revelation as a conflict between God and Satan being fulfilled in the present church age. So there's this great cosmic conflict between God, Satan, man caught in the middle, and that this book of Revelation just simply speaks about what we are experiencing in the church age. And you know what? I would say yes. I would definitely say that this is part of the book of Revelation. I don't think the book of Revelation is written just for the end times. I think the book of Revelation was written for the very experience of every age that people have lived in. Every age should be able to take encouragement from it. And so I think it's a beneficial method of interpretation, but I definitely do not think that is the ultimate method of interpretation. Number two is the preterist approach, a theological term to describe the view that the prophecies in Revelation have already been fulfilled. A picture of early church conflicts which have been fulfilled. And this this view denies the future predictive nature and quality of most of the book of Revelation. And you know, obviously disregarding the last sentence I said, I would agree that you could look at the book of Revelation and see how some of the things were actually in some minor way fulfilled in the first century, in the first few centuries. It's in some ways you can see a partial fulfillment back then, but I think to say that there's no future fulfillment or part, futuristic fulfillment of the book of Revelation, I find that really, really difficult. Although I would agree that you could see some unique fulfillments of that in the first centuries. Then there's the historical approach, a view from the Middle Ages. In the historical approach, which views Revelation as a symbolic picture of the total church history of the present age between Christ's first and second coming. These it's usually postmillennialism, and it's a thousand years, is not literal, it's just a long period of time, and that we are going through that that time at the moment. Now, I have a particular problem with this one because it's really hard to interpret and to pinpoint fulfillment of prophecies, right? In other words, you don't really read the Bible and watch a prophecy being fulfilled and an Old Testament prophecy being fulfilled and think to yourself, oh, I wonder if that was really a prophecy or not. It was very clear. It's not ambiguous. Jesus will be born in Bethlehem. He would come from Egypt. You know, and so you look at those two things and you think to yourself, well, that was fulfilled, you know. He would be pierced. He would be led like a lamb to the slaughter. There's no ambiguity here. It's quite clear the fulfillment of these prophecies. The problem with the historical approach is then we get into Chernobyl was this part or these other historical things. But never can we really pin it because when you read commentaries on it, everybody has a different take on it, a different fulfillment of those same verses in different times of history. So I really, really struggle with that one in particular. I mean, I'm not speaking down on it. I'm just saying I really do struggle with it. And finally, the fourth is the futuristic approach. Usually premillennials who state that the chapters 4 through 22 deal with events that are yet to be happen in the future. So you would have chapter 1, then you would have chapter 2 and 3, which would deal with the church, and then chapter 4, the church would no longer be there, and it is a time afterwards that it deals with, usually premillennialist. Chapters 4 through 18 describes the last 7 years preceding the second coming of Jesus, emphasizes the tribulation occurring in the last 3.5 years before his coming. And some objections to this view usually come from arguments against premillennialism. And objections include that this book would not have comforted the early church or understood or would have been understood by them if it was largely futuristic. Now, I personally, if you were to ask me, what do you think, Raf? What is your view on it? I really believe that the allegorical, non-literal interpretation or method of interpretation of the book of Revelation is good for our lives to, in every age, to draw strength from it. It is a cosmic battle. And we see John, this is many antichrists have come. So in many ways, you know, these things is repeating over and over and over again. So every age has been able to benefit from those chapters 4 through 22. In an allegorical sense, in an application to our lives sense. I believe the preterist approach is also one that is that describes the prophecies, how the early church went through those things. In many ways, you see Nero and just his evil and being a type of antichrist. And you could see how the preterist view, you could see how the book of Revelation, that was, yeah, it fits there. But it doesn't fit ultimately. Those are good for those ages. Those are good for us to see how it panned out then. But I believe that there's a futuristic view, and this is all still ahead of us. I believe it's literal. Of course, there's allegorical aspects. The seven heads, it's figurative language, but it has meaning, and it has to mean more, not less. And it should, and we should have the liberty to be able to glean from all these things as we read the book of Revelation. So, we're going to leave it there today. It was just like a taster menu. But realize the wonderful promise of how blessed that person will be who reads this book, who hears it read, and who obeys it. That we would take the warning, not to tamper with it, but to seek genuinely, what does it have to say to our lives? What is it communicating? And then to be able to take that wonderful, the person, the apostle of John, when Jesus said to him, come and you will see. And that we would be encouraged to follow Jesus. To realize what happened to him, and that what happened to him individually is what God wants to do with you individually and with us as humanity corporately as we listen to him and we listen to the words, come and you will see. He will always do exceedingly and abundantly beyond all we can think or ask. In my prayer for you and me today, is that we would be like the Queen of Sheba. That we will not travel distances, physical distances, but that we would draw near to Jesus in a spiritual journey. And that we would come to a place where there's no more breath left in us as we see his wisdom, as we see his majesty, as we see his servants, as we see him exalted, as we see him on the cross, as we see him in his miracles, as we see him as the restorer of heaven and earth. What an amazing prospect, what an amazing invitation we have in front of us. And how sad that oftentimes we stick with a little stubborn pride, like little children. I don't want to do this just because we think that that is bad for us. I don't want my vegetables. You know, I'm looking at my child. I don't want lettuce. And we're just stubborn. Or I don't want to go do this thing with Jonathan. What happened to me all the time. I don't want to go there. Just trust me, Jonathan. And then he would have a blast. Oh, be blessed as you follow Jesus. And some homework would be read the book of Revelation through. May God bless you. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much, Lord, for your word. Thank you for the book of Revelation. And I pray these weeks as we go through it, that we will not shrink away from it, that we will not be too bold in it, that we have our own little views, but that we will be able to just glean from it what you have put there for us to benefit us, to strengthen us, to fill our lives with hope, with comfort, with warning, with blessing. Oh Lord, thank you so much for not leaving us in the dark. And help us, Lord, help us to get over our pride. Help us to be humble and to yield and to say, what does the Creator of heaven and earth have to say to me? In Jesus' name, amen.
So my soul longeth after thee. You alone are desire and I long to worship Thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To You alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship You. I want You more than gold or silver. Only You can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. You alone are my strength, my shield. To You alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship Thee.
You are my friend.
My Father, even though You are a king, I love You more than any other, so much more than my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship You, and I long to worship. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but You have never failed me yet. Oh, waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for You have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is Your faithfulness, Your faithfulness. Still in Your hands, this is my confidence, You never failed me yet.
So I know the night.
I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing Your praise again.
Jesus, You're still not.
Jesus, You're still enough.
in your love. My heart will sing your praise again. It's your promise. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. So
So what a great prospect we have to be able to meditate and to read through and to learn and to apply this great book of Revelation. I have a friend who when I became a Christian, the person flew all the way from Germany to the States because she could not believe that my life had changed. And I still remember to this day, she spent several hours just reading the book of Revelation. And it was in reading the book of Revelation that she gave her life to the Lord. It shook her. It enlarged her heart. It showed her what's in the future. And it was just amazing to me. So be blessed as you read it. If you have questions about the book of Revelation, maybe questions about... whatever you have, as long as they're genuine questions. I would ask genuine questions, not trick questions. Then I would just ask them, whether it's on the women's group, the men's group, or whether it's actually right here on the webpage, and we'll try our best to answer them either through the messages, or maybe we'll make a special video for it to put online for you to be able to have an answer for the hope that we have in us. So, and have an answer just to the questions that we might have in our hearts as well. May you be overwhelmed. Remember, the Queen of Sheba was left with no more spirit in her. But Jesus said, one greater than Solomon stands here. And you know what? When John saw Jesus glorified, he fell down as dead. But then the wonderful thing, he wasn't there being crushed. He heard the words, you are greatly beloved. It is fearful sometimes to read certain things about judgment, about wrath, about the things that we read here, but always if we know that He's doing it because He loves. And as we humble ourselves before Him, that we would realize and we receive the words that we have this voice saying, "You are greatly beloved. And yes, I'm showing you this because I want to rescue you from it. And I want to rescue you into this new heaven and this new earth that I've provided and that I've been providing and that I've been preparing since the very Genesis, since the very beginning of it all. Since you guys, humanity, messed it all up, I've been preparing to fix this thing, and here's what it's going to look like." So may God bless you guys.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my Jesus, the only